in the on-bottom suspension and up-bottom suspension. So whenever there are solids and impeller speed is zero, practically all the solids are in settled form. They form a layer at the bottom. For the downflow impeller, when the impeller is started, a downflow jet is created by the impeller and the solids get accumulated in the corner region and we call it as a fillet. If it is an upflow impeller, then a cone is formed below the impeller. So that is at low impeller speeds. If we increase the speed further, all the particles, they get into motion and they get spread on the bottom again. And all of them are in motion, though they are on the bottom, none of them are stationary. If at all they are stationary, not more than 1 or 2 seconds. But important problem is they are on the bottom. So when all of them are in motion and they do not stay for at any one location for more than 1 or 2 seconds, this is called on-bottom suspension. When we increase speed further, all the particles are suspended from the bottom. Some of them do come to the bottom, but do not stay on the bottom for more than 1 or 2 seconds. This is called off-bottom suspension. And if we increase the speed further, then it is likely that the suspension comes up to this location. If we increase the speed further, then suspension may come up to this location. Right? And one sentence I mentioned to you, if these are heavy particles, then it cannot be homogenized. The liquid level is here, the liquid level is here. It cannot be taken at the top and the suspension is not 100% uniform. But if the particles are fine, like 500 microns, 100 microns, 50 microns, then we can make a uniform slurry. So the solid particles, have you received all the different industrial examples already? I promised you last time that I'll communicate to you large examples of industrial importance for liquid alone, gas liquid system, solid liquid system, liquid liquid system, gas liquid solid system. Have you received these?
Last time we received it when we did a couple of lectures last year.
But not this year. So this year I'll again organize to send under each category, each title, what are the examples of industrial importance. Aditi, you are knowing now. So you send it, try to make it. So send it as a separate mail where there are examples of industrial importance, only that much mail. Right. So there may be catalytic reactions or in hydrometallurgical operations, we encounter solid-liquid dispersions. It's a unit operation of leaching. So what I was going to tell you, that what is a thumb rule, whether we should suspend it up to 50%, 75%, 100%. So in majority of cases, we are all right if we attain the condition of off-bottom suspension and further uniformity of solids is not required. We get more uniformity at higher and higher impeller speed, but power consumption is proportional to cube of impeller speed. Right? And cube of impeller speed means power consumption increases. And because of further suspension, what is the extra benefit? The benefit is there, but it is not consistent with the power consumption. So the thumb rule is, we are happy if we attain the condition of up-bottom suspension. So the design parameter, the design objective in this case is critical impeller speed for up-bottom suspension or critical impeller, critical power consumption at up-bottom suspension. So this is a parameter. Earlier parameter was power consumption. All right. And then I showed you how to use the software. Now next time I may show you how to get this for different solids. And solids means particle size, particle density, and liquid density, which decides the particle settling velocity, right? Similarly, impeller design and the tank diameter and the quantity of solids that we put inside. For all these conditions, how to get critical impeller speed for up-bottom suspension, that will be a design objective, correct? Whenever we get at very low impeller speeds, these are not operational impeller speeds, but if we plot power consumption in presence of solids versus power consumption in the absence of solids, of course, when the impeller speed is close to zero, we have a condition where impeller rotates only in the liquid. So PS upon P is 1. At low speeds, when we get cone and fillet, the flow is streamlined in this region. The flow is streamlined in this region, and there is a little bit reduction in power consumption. But when we get to this condition or this condition, now the average density seen by the impeller is the average density of solid and liquid put together, which is more than. And therefore, PS upon P, that increases. And then it levels off when the solid suspension is more or less uniform. So this is the impeller speed. So if there is a, if we keep on increasing, suppose this is 2% loading, we make 5% loading, 10% loading, 30% loading, then in that case, we get graphs like this. So here the parameter is solid loading. Please remember my earlier statement, all of these are experimentally measured and plotted, right? Which will be embedded in the software, and you will get power consumption for any loading, for any particle size, for any particle density, for any liquid density, for any impeller diameter, for any impeller pipe, impeller type, for any vessel diameter. So those will be input parameters, and all the experimental data, they have been collected together and put it inside. This technique recently, there is a word coined, and it is called Generation 4 chemical industry. Have you heard of Euro 4 specification for fuel? That you have heard, right? So it means same thing, that sulfur dioxide should be this much, NOx should be this much. So Generation 4 means it is more efficient chemical industry than before. And efficient means what? For a certain capacity, the purchased equipment cost, it shall be much less than whatever has been before. The energy requirement, the manpower requirement is substantially lower than the earlier case, right? And this particular condition of generation 4 chemical industry is achieved through the technique of, through the method of artificial intelligence. Have you heard this word? Or machine language? Or data analytics? Big data? Right. So here, what is done? Several chemical engineering laboratories in the world, they have measured power consumption over a wide range of, somebody must have varied only solid loading, maybe from 0.1% to 40%. Somebody must have taken several impeller designs, but only one particle and one loading. Some in some other laboratory, there are variation in tank diameter. Or there is one laboratory where all the variables are covered, most of the variables are covered. And this way we have, say, 3,000, 4,000 points. Right? All those 4,000 points are collected. And those, all the possible impeller design, impeller diameter, impeller location, total liquid, tank diameter, particle size, particle density, liquid viscosity, find the critical impeller speed for off-bottom suspension. So all these data are there inside, and in the, see, I'm experienced, right? Your age is approximately 22. Little less, but say approximately 22. My age is 70. Now, if you ask me that I want to manufacture something and design stir tank, right? It is a gas liquid dispersion. What is the level of power consumption I should be using? I may answer 5. Why? I can give quick answer. Correct, no? So I'm trained in a simple language. I'm trained so much. I've designed so many reactors and learned through the design of all those equipment what is a good idea, right? So similarly, in this case, all the data are fed to the computer, and to the computer, the relationship between up-bottom suspension speed and particle size, and particle density, and liquid density. All those relationships, computer tries to learn. Every data point it tries to learn. And it tries to remember all those relationships in the artificial manner. And whenever we ask something, it gives answer like you got power consumption just now. And that intelligence is artificial intelligence. So the whatever technique has been used, one who has used Parikshit is there in front of you. He's using that technique and collecting and correlating all the data. But that correlation is through the technique of artificial intelligence. I don't know whether I may take one lecture on artificial intelligence, because that is the principal requirement for generation 4 chemical industry. Or I will have a word with your head of the department. I should not be teaching much, much more than what is there in the syllabus. What is there in the syllabus? I'll talk to your head of the department. Or I may invite the right person whose background is computer science and engineering, and it is their subject, the artificial intelligence. So they may teach in a better way. But let us see. But what I'm going to teach you definitely is process design, how to get the values of these parameters, and how to optimize the equipment design. This I will definitely teach you. Okay, now let me tell you, show you a series of pictures for gas liquid dispersion.
Sir, one question.
Yeah.
Sir, why the loading, there is an increase in minima with the increase in loading?
So you get more streamlined flow, no? So the corners are there. You try to fill the corners And whenever fluid tries to go to the corner, there vortices are generated. There is more turbulence. This means it has to consume more power. Yesterday, class was different, but you take a spherical particle and there is a flow past sphere.
Correct.
Then you know that there is a low pressure region on the rear side and vortices are generated. As you increase the flow further and there is an increase in the Reynolds number, the vortices release. We call them as eddies. Vortices are formed, these are released. And these eddies, they break, and then they move throughout the liquid in a free manner. So there is eddy size distribution, there is eddy velocity distribution, and together we call it as turbulence.
Correct.
So whenever there is any bluntness, so for reducing such a drag and making it streamlined, we don't make aeroplane spherical. Correct, no? So there is a streamlined flow in such a way that there is no boundary layer separation, and whatever vortices are generated on the rear side of the plane, those are very small. Maybe 5% turbulence and 95% streamlined flow. So whenever we are capable of generating streamlined flow and try to eliminate the turbulence, then the power required for that kind of flow, it goes down.
Right.
So whenever those corners are filled, then we get more streamlined flow and then we get less power consumption. So let me show you some pictures for gas liquid dispersion. The stirred tank, this is a sparger. That is, gas enters and there is a distributor. Imagine this to be a ring, and on the ring there are holes and gas is passing through this and there are bubbles. And impeller is stationary. Imagine impeller is stationary. Therefore, impeller is doing nothing and bubbles also move upwards. There may be some radial movement of the bubbles, but practically it goes upwards. Right. When the impeller speed is increased further, as you know, even if it is actually upward flow, towards the top, there is a flow reversal. There is a radial component as well. So bubbles try to move in the radially outward direction, right? So let us see the next one. So this is our condition one. You increase the impeller speed, the bubbles are spread radially outwards. These are spread further radially outwards.
All right.
And as you know, if this is upward impeller, there is downflow near the wall. And therefore, the bubbles are dragged downwards near the wall as we increase the impeller speed. So increase it further, these are dragged downwards and they come up to the level of impeller.
Right?
You increase the speed further, they are dragged down and they completely fill the entire vessel. And now bubbles are available everywhere in the vessel, and we call this as critical impeller speed for gas dispersion. This is the condition we want, that the bubbles are distributed everywhere. Right? We have taken a flow impeller. We have taken a flow impeller and there is a downflow, and the downflow drags the bubbles and takes it up to the bottom. Right? If we increase the speed further, then there is an upflow here and all the bubbles, they start recirculating back to the impeller, and these are further dispersed and broken, and the gas hold up, the bubble diameter keeps on reducing, and the holdup keeps on increasing. So if I show you again, right, impeller does nothing. Right. Impeller does something, little more, and it comes to the level of impeller. When the dispersion comes to the level of impeller, in the language of gas liquid dispersion, we say that impeller is now loaded.
Okay?
Impeller is loaded. When bubbles are there everywhere, then we call it, say that complete dispersion has occurred. All right? And then beyond that, there is now recirculation of bubbles to the impeller. This is called the condition of recirculation. Now, I'm going to explain to you what happens to the power consumption under these categories. For solid loading, it was fairly simple, but it is, we need to understand much more. For gas liquid dispersion. Try to understand one point which is straightforward, which is very simple. As we increase the impeller speed, the gas holdup in the tank increases. Or, in other words, the average density seen by the impeller, it decreases. And power is always equal to the density seen by the impeller multiplied by np rho n cubed d raised to 5. Right? So with an increase in impeller speed, power in the presence of gas divided by power in absence of gas keeps on decreasing as we increase the impeller speed. Is clear? Right. Of course, I'm going to tell you once more. There is one more reason. And I suggest all of you to concentrate on whatever I'm saying. Right. 100% concentration. Last time I must have said that whatever I'm talking is the most beautiful thing in this world. Assume that and concentrate on whatever I'm saying, okay? So take any impeller, and for discussion purpose, this impeller. But any impeller has some projected area like this. And whenever it rotates, there is a low pressure region on the rear side of the impeller. In this rear side, whenever gas is present, the gas goes and sits in that low pressure region and makes the flow, which is hydrofoil. Imagine case one, where gas is not there, and I'm drawing only projected part of the impeller, and now the flow is like this. And vortices are generated. Vortices are generated and they release, they break, and we get eddy size distribution, velocity distribution. So you measure somewhere else, you will see that this eddy motion appears in velocity versus time diagram as a fluctuation when eddy comes and goes, and we call it as a turbulent flow. When gas is there, and same blunt object, By blunt object, I mean the some projected area for the projected width. Now we have the same thing. There is a low pressure region, and now gas is there. This is an in absence of gas. This is in presence of gas. So in this low pressure region, gas goes and sits there inside, and it forms a shape which fills the low pressure region, and it is called cavity. It is called cavity. And it does not permit the formation of eddies, release of eddies, and creation of turbulence. It becomes a streamlined flow. Right? Or in other words, whenever flow becomes streamlined, the power consumption in presence of gas is less than power consumption in absence of gas. In absence, we have drawn, there is a turbulent flow, is a less turbulent flow. And obviously, you can show, now here mean will remain the same, but the level of turbulence will go down in the presence of gas. Now let me repeat. Power consumption in the presence of gas is less than the power consumption in absence of gas. And there are two reasons. One is average density goes down as the impeller speed increases because of increasing gas holdup. And power consumption decreases because of the formation of cavity behind the impeller. All right. This is part of the story. Now let me continue the story. Now increase the speed further. The cavity which is formed on the backside of the impeller, the shear, the velocity gradient in the vicinity of the cavity, it increases and it starts shearing the cavity. All right. And making small bubbles. And then there is a certain impeller speed which shears the entire cavity, and cavity is absent. Correct? Cavity is absent. How many things I told you? I showed you pictures. The gas is parched, impeller does nothing, and the gas bubbles flow upwards. Right? Increase the impeller speed, radial component is there, some spread is there, there is a downward component of liquid. The gas starts coming down, up to the impeller, increase the speed, it goes to the bottom, and then it recirculates back to the. This is one thing I told you. Another thing I told you is the average density as we go keep on forwarding in impeller speed, the gas holdup increases, the average density seen by the impeller, it decreases. And power consumption decreases. As we increase the impeller speed, the pressure behind the impeller, the extent of vacuum keeps on increasing with impeller speed, and the size of the cavity increases and power decreases. Beyond a certain shear, the cavity starts breaking, and at very high speed, the cavity breaks down completely. Non-existence of cavity, again generation of turbulence. Now all these points which I mentioned to you, I must now show you quantitatively, right? You remember everything, whatever I have told you? Yeah, very good. Power in presence of gas divided by power in absence of gas. When impeller speed is zero, more or less impeller rotates in the liquid.
Right.
And therefore we say that the value is one. Value is one. As impeller speed increases, there are two reasons for decreasing power consumption: lowering of average density and formation of cavity. And cavity size increases.
Right.
So therefore, there is reduction in power consumption. And we come to the point. Now the shearing of cavity starts. There were two reasons for the reduction of power consumption and one reason, that is formation of cavity. That particular reason is getting withdrawn now. And at some other speed, that is completely withdrawn. So there is a range of impeller speed where that particular reason is withdrawn and there is increase in power consumption. At this point, cavity size is zero. But if we increase the impeller speed further, holdup definitely increases, average density definitely decreases, and power consumption anyway is decreasing. So in this region, only one reason is withdrawn. Therefore, for a certain small range of impeller speed, there is increase in power. Physically, this point is loading, which I explained to you, that is the gas phase comes up to the level of impeller.
Right.
This point is recirculation. And somewhere here is complete dispersion. Understood? If not understood, the only option is you should ask me. Suppose we are here, complete dispersion has occurred and there is a recirculation as well. And now you don't touch impeller speed, there is a recirculation. There is a recirculation. Now you increase the gas flow rate. So recirculation condition goes to gas dispersion, increase the gas flow rate, complete dispersion goes to loading, increase the gas flow rate further, then the capacity of the impeller to disperse the gas keeps on decreasing, and at very high gas flow rate, impeller does nothing. Or in other words, since impeller is not capable of dispersing that much gas, we say that impeller is flooded, right? So this condition is called flooding. So this graph as shown is for particular gas flow rate. If you increase the gas and it is now again flooded at some gas flow rate, again you increase the impeller speed, there will be loading, there will be dispersion, there will be recirculation for that gas flow rate, right? So as the gas flow rate increases, obviously, the critical impeller speed for gas dispersion has to increase. All the speeds, loading speed, dispersion speed, recirculation speeds, all of them increase with respect to gas flow rate. Right? Try to, maybe one, suppose we are rotating impeller in liquid and sometimes we feel that let us increase the power consumption. Right? One way is to increase the impeller speed and increase the power consumption. Another way people feel that let us introduce gas and let us make use of pressure energy available with the gas, so that pressure energy plus kinetic energy put together, we are putting more energy. But what happens in reality? Gas goes inside, average density increases, decreases, cavity formation is there, and actual power consumption is less than, rather than increasing power consumption, right? So if the solids are suspended and we feel that we want to suspend more, let us pass gas. Gas is passed, power consumption decreases, whatever was earlier suspension, it collapses because of the introduction of gas. Understood? Because of the reduction in power. Right? Any difficulty? Anything you want to ask?
Sir, if we introduce the gas, do we have better suspension or not good suspension? In gas solid liquid system, if we are introducing gas, then what will be the suspension, good or bad?
Let me explain to you. For a solid suspension, we saw the sequence of cavity formation, particle starts moving, becoming loose, all of them are on the bottom, there is on-bottom suspension, there is off-bottom suspension, and then there is a suspension, 25% of the vessel, 50% of the vessel, 75%. So that sequence you remember? Now the quality of suspension obviously depends upon how much we have put power inside.
Right.
If there is 50% suspension and if there is 25% suspension, obviously for 50% suspension, we must have put more power as compared to 25% suspension. Is this clear? Right. If we reduce the power further, it can go to the condition of off-bottom suspension. If you reduce power further, it becomes on-bottom suspension. If you reduce it further, then it will be some cone or unsettled condition.
Correct?
Right. Now suppose it is 50% suspension and there is a certain power consumption, say 1 kW/m³. At that condition, right? Now you pass gas. Now you know everything. When you pass gas, the density seen by the impeller starts reducing. Cavity formation starts. And actual power consumption goes down from, say, 1 to perhaps 0.8. And 50% suspension becomes 30% suspension. Increase the gas flow rate becomes 20% suspension. Increase the gas flow rate, power consumption goes down, and all the particles, they collapse down and sit on the vessel. Understood? Any other point? Yeah.
Gas is coming from the bottom of the reactor.
Yeah.
Fluid is the make the solid.
Yeah.
So in that case, we are using gas.
So the question is, in a fluidized bed, the quality of fluidization and quality of suspension improves as we increase the superficial gas velocity. And here you are explaining, my dear sir, that as the gas velocity increases, the suspension collapses. That is the question. Correct, no? Can anybody give the answer? Yeah. Yeah.
So the, in fluidized bed, power is imparted by the flow of gas or liquid.
Yeah.
In this case, the power is not imparted by gas, but it is imparted by the impeller.
Yeah, that's right. So in fluidized bed, as we increase the gas velocity, this is a pressure energy equipment, we are introducing more and more power to the system, and particle gets not only suspended, there is a bed expansion, correct? So power is increasing continuously there. Whereas in this case, when we pass gas and increase the volumetric flow rate, the power consumption has in fact reduced because of two reasons: the density seen by the impeller and formation of gravity. And when power consumption goes down to, say, 60%, 50% of the original power consumption, it will do the job according to the 50% power consumption. And therefore, earlier suspended solids, they try to settle, or the quality of suspension becomes poor. All right? So the mechanism of suspension, I think, let me explain in some other words. In fluidized bed, what happens? We call the particle to be fluidized when gravity minus buoyancy is equal to drag. Right? That is the mechanism of suspension. And then there is a minimum fluidization velocity at which this force balance is satisfied. And then I explained to you in greater detail. I don't remember whether I taught you or whether I taught third year. You were in third year last year. Yeah. But I did not teach you. Right. So when you increase the gas velocity further, see, gravity is m into g. Buoyancy is m of liquid into g. The mass of liquid that it displaces, solid into g, that is buoyancy. And gravity minus buoyancy for a given particle is independent of whether that particle is a fluidized bed or stirred tank or in a cyclone or imagine any place or in this classroom. Gravity minus buoyancy is the same. Right? When equals drag, then it remains suspended. So at minimum fluidization velocity, the force balance is satisfied. As we increase the gas further, if the drag coefficient remains the same, then the particle cannot remain in the vessel. But the particles, they try to get separated from each other. What is the meaning of drag coefficient or drag force? You have derived the equation for laminar flow, parabolic velocity profile. And velocity gradient multiplied by viscosity is stress. Stress multiplied by area on which stress is acting is called drag force.
Right.
When particles are touching each other, now you must be highly concentrating on whatever I'm saying, 100%, like a laser. like a laser, concentrate. See, whenever there is a fixed bed and flow happens, on the solid surface everywhere there is a no slip boundary condition. Everywhere only. And particles are close to each other. So whatever may be the velocity, close to that velocity there is a condition of no slip. Velocity has to be zero. Therefore, velocity gradients keep on increasing. All right. So for that velocity gradient multiplied by surface area, the drag force then becomes equal to gravity minus buoyancy. Now, when you increase the gas velocity, the condition that drag force is equal to gravity minus buoyancy has to sustain. This cannot be, we cannot violate this law. So what happens to drag force? The reason for increasing drag force was there were nearby particles, voidage was less, true velocity increased because voidage was less, and there were adjoining locations where velocity has to be zero. So at increased velocity, particles try to separate from each other, and therefore the locations at which velocity is zero, they get apart from each other. Velocity gradients reduce, but velocity has increased. Therefore, velocity gradient tries to adjust a condition that resulting drag force is equal to gravity minus buoyancy. You increase the gas flow rate further, particles separate from each other, so that gravity minus buoyancy is equal to drag. Understood? So this is the mechanism. What happens in the stirred tank? Right? What happens in the stirred tank? Why do we call there is a certain power consumption required for the suspension of solid particles? Let me give you a simple explanation and let me give you a complex explanation, both of them. I will give simple first, simple explanation. Whenever we release a particle in a fluid, it attains terminal settling velocity. Very simple. Now, whatever is your cylinder in which you are doing experiment, you create an afflow which is equal to terminal settling velocity, then you will see that particle is stationary. In other words, we will call it as the particle is suspended. Right? Now, if that condition can be achieved in stirred tank, that wherever there is a flow, and in a flow impeller, there is a flow in the central region and downflow near the tank wall. So in the flow region, when the condition is attained that the local liquid velocity is higher than the particle settling velocity, the particle starts suspending. They go up. In the downflow, they try to come down, but again they go up. But as an external observer, we see that all the particles are suspended. See, you are a particle, say for example. Once you are in a fluidized bed and once you are in a stirred tank, don't be afraid of anything. You will not hit the impeller. Huh? Yeah. When you will get suspended? Simple law, drag is equal to gravity minus buoyancy. And when a flow becomes equal to settling velocity, exactly the same condition is satisfied. So the basic mechanism of suspension in fluidized bed and in stirred tank is identical. So this upflow velocity, that upflow velocity, the number, it depends upon the power consumption, right? So if the power consumption is 1 kilowatt per meter cube, then a flow velocity is sufficient for suspension. Because of some reason, you reduce the impeller speed, you pass the gas, and power consumption has come down to say 0.5 kilowatt per meter cube, the upward velocity decreases and particle settles. Understood? Very good. Very good. All of you have understood? What I like, I must tell you, I like your class. Whatever comes to your mind, you ask. And why it is useful? The doubt that anybody has, typically it is the doubt of everybody. Not it is of any the person, right? And therefore, entire class gets the benefit of additional explanation. Right? You must have tired. Perhaps I also might have tired, right? But I'm going to continue. We have really less time, really less time. Maybe next time, we should serve a cup of tea in the class. Or how about ice cream? Ice cream, yeah. Double scoop? Aditi, how many varieties you want? Perhaps one variety each. Correct? So, yeah, please, yeah, yeah. You want to say something? Yeah.
Sir, if you introduce gas, your turbulent flow will decrease, but your mean flow velocity will remain the same, right?
Yeah, that is true. Okay. Now see the beauty of this question, and you will realize this beauty when I give the explanation and you understand the explanation. Then you will understand the beauty. You have studied flow through pipeline, right? And you have studied laminar flow and turbulent flow.
Yes.
You know parabolic velocity profile, you know 1/7 power law, you know everything, correct? And we calculate pressure drop and you do experiments in the laboratory and try to plot friction factor versus Reynolds number. In laminar flow, you get 16 upon NRE, and in turbulent flow, you get something, correct? As the pipe becomes rough, at the same Reynolds number, you get higher friction factor. Correct? You make it rougher and rougher, you get more friction factor. Is that right? What happens? The roughness, you exaggerate the roughness, and it is a blunt object. And you have flow past immersed body, and vortices get generated behind the roughness, and turbulence is generated. As the roughness increases, the pressure drop increases. Correct? So the drag coefficient increases. You have seen, if you write for the particle the force balance, gravity minus buoyancy. So is this clear? Before I erase this, you remember and try to recite at least 3 times that friction factor increases with increase in roughness. Or say any number of times till I erase this. Volume of the particle into density of the particle, which is really mass of the particle, into acceleration due to gravity, minus volume of the particle into density of liquid into g. This part is clear? Right. How do we write left-hand side? Can anybody help me? CD pi by 4 dp square half rho into velocity square, which is typically slip velocity square, slip velocity between particle and liquid. Have you recited, how many times you have recited? 10 times, all right. So whenever there is enhanced turbulence, there is enhanced drag coefficient, right? And when turbulence is removed, there is reduction in drag coefficient. So for satisfying this equation, CD pi by 4 d square into half into rho is a constant. And CD into V square, under all the conditions for satisfying this equation, that has to remain. And when turbulence is eliminated, CD goes down and Vs has to increase. That is the settling velocity of the particle. So when we eliminate turbulence, the drag coefficient of the particle goes down and particle settles. I'll tell you what exactly is the difficulty in your mind, what is not, what prevents the understanding. Not prevents actually, because eventually you are going to understand. The ability of visualization. The question was, we withdraw turbulence, mean flow remains the same, let us assume that, but with power consumption that also goes down, but the question is right, but the question is right. The answer being given is, the settling velocity of the particle, that itself increases whenever we withdraw turbulence. And whatever is the mean velocity is not sufficient for suspending the particles under those conditions. Now understood? Once more? Can I assume that fluidized bed we have understood completely? Yes? No? Yeah, fluidized bed we have understood. Now, in the case of stirred tank, the mechanism of solid suspension, basically it has two components. As we increase the impeller speed, the turbulence level increases, drag coefficient increases. The slip velocity required for suspension, the slip velocity decreases, and for a given mean flow, it gets suspended. Right. So the downward velocity of the particle equals the upward velocity, but the downward velocity of the particle itself goes down as the level of turbulence increases, because the drag coefficient increases with the level of turbulence. Now we are withdrawing turbulence by introduction of gas. And we have seen several reasons, and power consumption has gone down overall. And let us presume that it is entirely because we have withdrawn turbulence from the system. Turbulence is removed. What is the result? The drag coefficient goes down. The slip velocity or the settling velocity of the particle increases. Whenever there was earlier level of power consumption, there was certain upward velocity which was capable of suspending those particles having that kind of settling velocity. Now settling velocity has increased. Withdraw turbulence, settling velocity has increased, and whatever was the upward velocity is not sufficient for suspending particles. They settle down. Understood? Understood?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. That is the benefit to everybody. The question was apparently straightforward. But if you understand the physical significance, what happens the physics behind it, then we get deeper insight into the performance of mixing equipment. I think that is more important than yes, yes.
Sir, you said as we eliminate every loss, the value of CD goes down. But the CD versus RE graph, when we plot drag coefficient versus Reynolds number, so the drag coefficient reduces with
the. Yeah. That is correct. When you it is slip velocity is relative velocity
between the particle and the fluid.
And the fluid. And the fluid.
So how, if turbulence decreases, how VS increases, slip velocity increases?
Okay, let me start again. Okay, let me start again. One thing is certain, that drag force has to be equal to gravity minus buoyancy all the time. We cannot touch gravity. We cannot touch buoyancy, we cannot touch the balance, the difference between the two. Perfect? Right. Okay. Now consider flow through pipeline. Flow is smooth. There is a certain friction factor. There is a certain shear rate. There is a certain stress multiplied by wall area. We call it as drag force. Correct? When the wall becomes rough for the same velocity, more turbulence is generated, friction factor increases, the shear stress increases, the overall drag force increases. Right? Increase the roughness further, the friction factor further increases, or the drag force further increases, right? And we get increased pressure drop. Or in other words, with an increase in turbulence, the drag force increases. Now here, we want certain drag force which has to be equal to gravity minus buoyancy. Any increase in roughness will increase the drag force. Right? So if you want to maintain the drag force, the same drag force, then the level of turbulence and upward velocity put together, then only drag force will be equal to gravity minus buoyancy. You withdraw turbulence, you withdraw roughness, in other words, friction factor reduces, but we call it here drag coefficient for this case. Whenever flow is parallel to the solid surface, we name it as friction factor. Whenever flow is not parallel, the same parameter, we call it drag coefficient. But you can keep on calling it friction factor, it doesn't matter. And for pipe flow also, you can call it as drag coefficient because physical significance is exactly the same, right? Right. So the slip velocity means the relative velocity, the settling velocity of the particle. So when we said the upward liquid velocity is equal to settling velocity and particle is suspended, at that point, the relative velocity between particle and liquid, call it as a relative velocity or call it as slip velocity, right? Multiplied by CD, multiplied by pi by 4 dp square, multiplied by rho is equal to gravity minus buoyancy, correct? Now that CD has a certain value, CD cap has a certain value, and if it is a single particle, that CD versus RE graph, this you might have studied, and that was the question which I was supposed to answer. That is, say this is 0.1, and then 1, and then 10, and 100, and 1,000, and then 10 raised to 4 and 10 raised to 5. Have you studied this over the entire range? Because I shouldn't. Over the entire range? but let me draw. So up to Reynolds number of 1, the flow is a creeping flow or laminar flow. Whenever it is more than approximately 1,000, the Reynolds number more or less remain constant, and the value is 0.44. And in the transition region, this is exactly power number versus Reynolds number, right? Whatever happens. Now this drag coefficient versus Reynolds number graph has been plotted. You release a particle, you take different sizes of particle, different densities of particle, different viscosities of liquid, different densities of liquid, release the particle, measure Vs, measure Reynolds number, measure drag coefficient, and draw a plot. And in the literature, you will see this plot. But it is for which condition? That is a single particle present alone in an infinite fluid, and we get CD versus RE graph. Now you imagine in the liquid, you deliberately generate 5% turbulence everywhere. Now the settling particle will be a rough particle. The drag coefficient increases. And then that CD versus RE graph, when there is a turbulence in liquid, that will be like this now. And instead of 0.44, it will level off at CD is equal to 1. Understood? See, when pipe is roughened, then there are blunt projections, and eddies are generated and flow becomes turbulent. And turbulent flow means eddies of different sizes and velocities within the liquid. Right? Now, whether that turbulence is generated by the solid surface or turbulence is introduced by some other means to the liquid, the overall effect is the same. The flow is turbulent. Now, instead of the momentum transfer, I think I explained this last time, because of molecular motion, that is the viscosity property into velocity gradient, or mass transfer, diffusivity into concentration gradient, or conductivity into temperature gradient, and all are molecular. There are certain rates of transfer, right? But when you make the flow turbulent, the eddy viscosity, the eddy diffusivity, the eddy conductivity is orders of magnitude higher than molecular viscosity, molecular, and momentum transfer is high. The momentum transfer is high. This itself means the stresses are high, friction factor is high, drag coefficient is high. Understood? This is the benefit. All of you have understood? Increases the drag coefficient. For the same Reynolds number, it increases the drag coefficient here. Because in the definition of Reynolds number, whatever we have, it does not consider the level of turbulence. Any other question? I have decided to teach you till 7. So if you ask me any question, perfectly all right. No question, I'll teach further now. Okay. Next slide. This is very interesting. I'm going to tell you some modified designs of stirred tank. Are you alert?
Yes, sir.
some modified designs. There are special requirements, therefore special designs. And what are those special requirements? There are many gases, the solubility of which in the liquid is limited. Oxygen, for example, or hydrogen in particular, the solubility is less. Solubility of carbon dioxide is good. Of nitrogen oxides is very good. Some of the gases, ammonia is very good, extremely good. But there are gases, and you introduce from the bottom, take any tank, you introduce from the bottom, and during the stay of bubbles within the liquid, the extent of dissolution is incomplete. And when the bubble rises up to the top, collapses, and goes to the gas space, during that travel from the bottom to the top, there is limited dissolution. And most of the gas goes to the gas space in an unabsorbed manner. Right? Suppose we want a certain pressure for this reaction. Right? So what will happen? Unreacted gas goes up to the top, pressure increases, and if you want to maintain the pressure, the introduction of gas itself will stop. Correct? Understood? I'll explain once more. You are alert, I'm able to see your faces, but just for my benefit, I'll explain it once more. Yeah, okay? I'm going to teach you now some special requirements for which we need to improve the design of stir tank. So what is that special requirement and how it is modified that I'm going to teach you now? Right? And one such requirement is the gases are sparingly soluble. The word sparingly means it has low solubility, okay? It's sparingly soluble. What it indirectly means, whatever may be the height of liquid, during the travel of gas, suppose bubble is 5 millimeter diameter at the bottom, it definitely dissolves while it is rising, but the extent of dissolution is not up to the mark that it doesn't absorb 100% till it goes to the top. And unreacted gas goes to the gas space. There is a certain volume of the gas space, there is a certain size of the equipment, liquid is filled up to the level, and there is a certain gas space. For a given pressure and for a given volume, it can accommodate certain quantity of gas in the gas space. It cannot take more quantity of gas because pressure is there, volume is there. And you know which law holds? I'm asking, in the gas space, if there is a certain given volume of gas space and certain level of desired pressure, it cannot take more gas. In that, what is that gas? That is Boyle's law. Or in general, we can say ideal gas law. Boyle's law is acceptable. But Henry's law, that answer is also correct till the bubble was rising. And sparingly soluble, the indirect meaning is Henry's coefficient is low. Therefore, it is sparingly soluble, right? So what do we do? So whatever is the solubility, and whatever is the residence time of the bubble, and whatever is the rate of absorption, we need to be happy. And therefore, I'm telling you this story in early 80s. And hydrogenation reaction used to take 7 days, 10 days, 15 days, 20 days, depending upon whatever is the quantity to be processed, correct? Whatever is required. There was an excellent development in Germany and Switzerland to recycle the gas, whatever is unreacted, bring it back to the liquid. This is a special requirement and now a special design. Have you understood special requirement? Right. Now the special design. One such simple design is you put the impeller as close to the top surface as possible. Right. It will create turbulence on the surface, waviness, some bubbles will get entrapped and some gas will get sucked into the liquid, get entrained into the liquid, and it is called surface aeration. And you have already completed work practice in plant training. And if you would have seen the effluent treatment plants, there are surface aerators. The liquid is splashing and the gases, bubbles are going inside. All these are called surface aerators. By the meaning surface aerators, the gas liquid dispersion prevails only in the top region. And we cannot and never attain a condition of complete dispersion, right? No, because impeller is at the top, and wherever impeller is active, only in that active region the bubbles will get entrained inside. But it is improvement, and it was innovation at that time. And those equipment manufacturers, they sold the equipment on the basis of only surface aeration. Further, next slide. This is surface aeration. That is, impeller is closer to the top, and gas liquid dispersion is say up to the impeller, little bit below the impeller. Next. Now, are you able to see the modification? There is an impeller. It is enclosed in a hood. There is a concentric pipe. There is a concentric pipe, and there is an opening in gas space. When you rotate the impeller, the Bernoulli's equation holds. You increase kinetic energy. There is a reduction in pressure energy, and there is low pressure region. Otherwise, what is the pressure here? Equal to h rho g. If the reduced pressure is less than gas phase pressure, then gas starts flowing through the opening up to the impeller. Correct? All right. But still the dispersion is not up to the bottom. Therefore, the next slide. Now the inducing impeller is at the bottom. And now the dispersion is complete. But what is the difficulty? We need to create low pressure region in such a way that it is lower than the gas space pressure. And the speed required, or at the same speed, the rate of induction is less. Right? Therefore, the next slide, there is an impeller which is close. The pressure that it has to overcome is equivalent to h rho g, and there is another impeller which does the job of distributing gas, whatever is induced by the inducing impeller. All right? So this is the innovation. And the next is, if such an equipment is used for gas liquid solid dispersion, you know that the dispersing impeller in presence of gas, it doesn't do a good job. I told you in great detail that the power consumption decreases, but there are special suspending impellers. I may explain you, and one more impeller provided, the next one, that is a suspending impeller. These are catalyst particles. And now, those 15 days, 20 days have been brought down to 3 hours because of the internal circulation of gas. I'll tell you a small story, which I tell every year to to all the classes. In mid-80s, such an equipment was indeed developed in Germany and Switzerland. And we were doing hydrogenations 10 days, 15 days, 20 days. They were doing it in 3 hours. We were not competing. We are not competing till today. We need a lot of innovations. Anyway, those plenty stories I will tell you. I have a lot of stories. What is that we engineers should be doing? We should not look forward for simple, simple things. Some 3-bedroom, 4-bedroom flat, and say 1 car, 2 cars, and something is air conditioned. Car is air conditioned, office is air conditioned, home is air conditioned. And then wife or husband or children. This happens with everybody. There is nothing that you do, anything great in that. This happens. If you are able to innovate, and innovate only one in lifetime, then you are happy really. Then you have done something. Then you are an ICT student. Right? And every one of you is capable. I'm ready to give you a certificate. I'm not your current vice chancellor, but as a past vice chancellor, I can give you a certificate that everybody of you is capable. Only have a desire. Try to develop an ability of concentration. 1 hour, 2 hours, have a cup of tea or ice cream side by side, and keep on thinking about it. Everybody will be able to innovate. Went to Switzerland, and 2-ton reactor was required. And Switzerland, that fellow manufacturer, he quoted 10 crores of rupees for 2-ton reactor. All right. I came back. 10 crores is, of course, in those days, it is 85, 86. It was impossible to pay. By the way, the metal required, the stainless steel required quantity was equivalent to 15 lakh rupees. And it was quoted to be 10 crores of rupees. At the same time, dollar price was 10 rupees, 85. So 10 crores means in terms of dollars, it was 1 crore dollars. 15 lakh rupees is the metal price. I came back. Then my friend, industry friend, he said, we have excellent fabrication facilities. Why 15 lakhs should go to 10 crores? We will save a lot of money. Let us bring only drawings. No? Yeah. I went back. And these people really quickly agreed that we will give drawings. Not only that, we will give loan also, 10 crores, because a lot of money is lying in Switzerland. So we'll give you money also on loan with 5% interest. Okay. But the cost of drawings is 9 crore 70 lakhs. And you say whatever you want. Since I was an ICT student, and I am an ICT student, the blood boiled. Came back, and I told you the story. This was developed in early 90s by students who look like you. And we made 15 lakh metal price, 15 lakh fabrication, and in 30 lakh rupees, the entire equipment was fabricated, and the hydrogenation time was 3 hours again, right? Then now who will import? Who will import? The price of dollar increased to 20 rupees a dollar from 10 rupees. These people reduced the price to 5 crores. So in terms of dollars, it must have reduced by 4 times. But since it is available, I implemented such design, not only for hydrogenation, for variety, at 200 locations, and all of them are in successful commercial operation. I'm telling you how to get Padma Bhushan. And everybody is capable. What I'm trying to tell you, to develop a desire and develop an ability to concentrate on one problem, concentrate on one problem, that there is some problem, whatever is homework given, there are various ways of completing the homework. Let us opt the way of concentrating oneself and complete the homework. That really gives us the ability, the right ability. My teacher was Professor Sharma, and he gave me 40, the entire class 40 problems to solve in the area of mass transfer. All those problems I will also give you. I'm teaching you process design now. Anyway, I'll take a decision. I was the only person who solved all those 40 problems and submitted all of them. And I did it myself. I'm telling you how to get Padma Bhushan. You're getting the meaning out of it. You're getting the meaning out of it. So this is a special requirement and special design. Maybe I'll now tell you only a few more things and then we will close. Next. That is correct. Yeah. That is correct. But see, present condition, we are having 20 refineries in the country. One more is now expected in Ratnagiri. But we are going to import all the technology all over again. We have not learned anything from 19 refineries. There are 75 fertilizer plants. 76, whenever it is planned, we are going to get technology from outside. And you have seen the difference between the price if you develop in-house and if you buy outside, right? And we are keeping doing like this years together till today. New petrochemical plant, buying from outside, again, any catalytic reactor. Import catalysts from outside. We are importing crude oil from outside. And there are so many opportunities. Maybe I'll give you a special lecture separately. I should not consume time from this class for explaining. But I think we as chemical engineers, are we incapable to solve these problems? I think we should look inwards and see what are the solutions to the problems offered by these outsiders. I don't care really who gives the solution. But it should not cost us. Nation is poor, and it should never cost us. It should cost according to whatever is the correct price. If it is not the correct price, then we should be able to innovate and bring it down to the correct price. Or don't depend upon the external intelligence at all. Right? Next, any question up till now? In terms of principle. Okay, so for the similar application, there is a called jet loop reactor. And jet loop reactor means the liquid from the bottom is lifted with pump and it goes through venturi. And in venturi, as you know, the throat is low pressure region. And that low pressure region sucks gas from the gas phase. And gas liquid dispersion is thrown by venturi into the liquid. With available kinetic energy, it can go up to certain distance and then there is a clear liquid. Below this, the bubbles rise. They don't have sufficient energy to go down. And this is called a jet loop reactor. Next. This is plunging jet reactor. That is the same pump goes through the nozzle and you must be taking bath every day. No, silence means nothing. And a bucket. And start the tap. When the jet hits the liquid surface, the bubbles are entrained inside. All right? The same principle is used here. There is sufficient kinetic energy, and then there is a gas liquid dispersion. Next. Now try to imagine this is the same cylindrical vessel is made horizontal. There is a shaft in between, and to the shaft, the disks are attached. These are the disks, and disks are rotating. And liquid level is up to this stage. So whenever this disk rotates and it comes out of the liquid, some layer is retained on the liquid, right? And then the gas liquid contact happens there, and whatever reaction happens, then again it comes back to the liquid, and the gas which is inside, it flows like this. That is, so that there is no back mixing in the gas phase. So this is called the rotating biological reactor. No, sir. Next. Have you understood? Huh? Simple, no? I think I will stop here.